If you think investing is very easy, then I would like to remind you of a quote from the legendary investor George Soros, who said investing has to be boring and not really very interesting. If it is interesting, then you're not doing something.
Kala, who are you the controlling one? Can you put everybody on mute, please?
Yes.
We are doing it.
Who is this here?
Everyone is in mute.
Kala, Shilpa, Finance, just check that. There's a participant called Shilpa Finance. Yeah, try. No, still not unmute.
It's all on mute now. Sorry, Pavan.
No worries. That's okay.
May I request all the participants to mute, please? And help us with the
Yes.
Good to go, Pavan, now, please.
Sorry, Pavan.
No worries at all. Yeah, moving on. So whenever I talk about foregoing consumption today for a later date, a lot of them say, ki kal kisne dekha hai? Who has seen tomorrow? Why bother with all of this complexity? Why not just live today? Like most people say, who's seen the world tomorrow? What if the world ends tomorrow? And if you think this is a question out of context, not really. Some of the best minds of humanity have spent a lot of time thinking about is the end for mankind on this planet somewhere near. So I'll start off with one of the earliest economists, Thomas Robert Malthus. In 1798, he wrote a very seminal essay, which the crux of that essay was population grows on an exponential curve. And resources to take care of that population, be it food, clothing, shelter, grows on a linear scale. So he said, mathematically, the end of mankind is near and inevitable. So he had painted a very, I would say, pessimistic picture of the future of mankind on this planet. And what he wrote in that essay had tremendous impact on how a lot of governments across the world adopted a lot of policies. And if you think this was more than 225 years ago, in fact, as recently as 50 years ago, there was another best-selling book by Stanford University biologist, Paul Ehrlich, who also rang the alarm bells on mankind. And he said, he had titled his book, The Population Bomb. And he said, a lot of millions of human beings are going to die because of starvation, especially small children, in 1970s and 1980s on this planet. And of course, we all know how it turned out, but his book had a lot of impact on government policies across the world. For example, that was a time when China adopted one-child policy. That was a time when a lot of governments across the world had forced sterilization drives and whatnot. And we know a lot of those alarm bells did not really pan out the way the author had anticipated. Moving on, one last example, and this is from the pandemic that we've all seen and are still experiencing are in the midst of that pandemic. So this is actually what appeared on the front page of the New York Times, wherein the author was trying to predict how long would it take for a COVID-19 vaccine to be rolled out. And in that study, based on typical timelines that a vaccine takes, the author had guessed or predicted, forecasted that the earliest that we could see a COVID-19 vaccine would be the month of November, but year would be 2033. And we are not yet in November 2022. And I think most of us on today's call have had a shot of hope, so to say. So yeah, moving on. So I think the bottom line, the key takeaway that I want to imbibe here, which is said very well by Dogbert, which is that stop worrying about the world ending tomorrow. Nobody knows the future, and that's a fruitless exercise. Instead, let's focus our energies on something which we can try and make sense of. So with that fear of the world ending tomorrow being out, then it's a question of how do we invest? The chart that you're going to see right now is probably one of the most, defining charts when it comes to investment decisions that someone would take. This chart tracks real return across asset classes for United States. Of course, that's one of the very few countries which has data going as far back. So you have data for almost 220 years here. And this chart tells you a lot of very interesting things. So first and foremost, it says that if you had a dollar invested in 1801, how much would that become across these asset classes in the year 2014? And that's very interesting because it says if you had invested that in cash, almost 95% of it, its value would have been eroded. And the value of that $1 today, 200 years later, would just be 5 cents. Another very interesting fact, especially for a lot of Indians who are on this call, is our fascination towards the yellow metal. If you look at what gold has delivered, and of course, what I'm about to say might not be liked by a lot of people on the call, but gold in the long run, at least if you look at the returns that it has delivered in the US over a 200 year period, has been pretty dismal. A dollar in gold has turned into just $3, and that too after 200 years. And likewise, I think the another key takeaway here is if you look at the row which talks about GDP growth. So it says GDP has grown at about 3.6% over the last 220 years in the US, and by which a dollar invested in economic activity has grown roughly 1800 times. And that is something, a takeaway that I want you to ponder about. And it actually tells us that somehow in the long run, an innate commodity would not outperform the human ability, which is what GDP sort of captures, right? The human economic activity. And of course, I think the single biggest takeaway here is what has happened with equities. Equities delivered in terms of real return, 6.7% over 220 years, wherein a dollar invested has become $10,33,287. Now, while comparing with other asset classes, even if you were to take out that 10 lakhs, right? If you were to take that million away, it still outperforms every other asset class in the long run. And that's the key message. This is probably one of the key messages I would want all the members to take away, that in the long run, equities outperform all other asset classes by a wide, wide margin. And that is something which we should be mindful of. Moving on, of course, this is about the US. All that's okay. How does it play out, or how does it seem to have worked in India? So here again, let's look at, of course, we do not have as much documented history about performance of all asset classes in India. But to the extent, I will try and make a case for equities in India. And if you look at the oldest index that we have, which is the S&P BSE Sensex, it was constituted almost 43 years ago. On 1st of April 1978, it had a value of 100. And 43 years later, on 1st of April, it had touched 50,000. And that means it has grown 500 times in this ensuing 40 odd years, which means at a compounded annual growth rate, average growth rate comes to about 15.5%. Of course, this is nominal growth rate. It includes real growth rate plus inflation. in fact, the third row there, which talks about what does the performance become if you chose to reinvest dividends, which each of these Sensex companies had paid out. If you had invested that into Sensex again, that 50,000 actually would have become 73,000 in value. And if you look at it in terms of percentage CAGR wise, it's just a difference of 1%. But I think this is the beauty of compounding, that even 1% difference over the long run creates a huge impact. So it's like you would have had 50% more return in absolute terms if you had reinvested into Sensex during this time. And of course, while we do not have data here, I think we can all do back of the envelope calculation and see whichever asset class you think about, be it real estate, gold, bonds, or any other asset class, and just try and see, has it grown 500 times or 700 times during this time frame? And that's I would say that is an appropriate way to think about performance of each of these asset classes. In fact, to avoid inconsistency, I have not even considered the value as of, say, yesterday. As of yesterday, these numbers become far higher. I think in terms of with dividends reinvested, it's almost 83,000. So a return of 835x during these 43 years. All of this should lead us to one question, which is, why is it that equities outperform? And I think the definition or the answer to that is that stocks or equities is actually a fractional ownership of a business. So when you buy a stock, whether you own a stock in a neighborhood bakery, or whether you buy a stock of Facebook, Google on the American stock exchanges, it all means the same. You own a piece of a business. And business as a construct is a very wonderful construct where it converts human ingenuity into growing profits for its owners for the long, long run. In fact, look at it. Public markets are probably the only forum whereby even a common man can partner with some of the finest human beings ever. Whether you want to partner with Jobs, Gates, startup, sky's the limit. Which other investment asset class gives you that optionality, right? The other thing, of course, we've discussed equities. The reason why it has given such stellar returns is the compounding aspect. And tie in the benefit of diversification and liquidity, then I think a lot of those other asset classes are light years behind the attractiveness of equities as an asset class. Of course, a lot of people do tell me that volatility on the stock markets is huge. So this is one of the constructs there that you have to understand, that equities is an auction-driven mechanism. And what happens in auction-driven markets is you would always have herd behavior. And owing to human emotions, the move of the market would always oscillate between the extremes. So there will be times when markets are so bullish about our existence on this planet. There will be times, as we saw in March, April last year, when markets probably predict the end of mankind is here and near. So that's the impact of auction-driven markets. But we have to take it in our stride. And I think most importantly, what really matters is, are you working with something called a margin of safety? So when you buy into something, and we'll, of course, look at this in more detail with specific examples. So the bottom line here is business converts human genius into growing profits for its owners forever. And that's why bet on human ingenuity by owning a business. Moving on, of course, a lot of people who talk about taking our point forward about the huge volatility in stock prices, the question a lot of people have in their minds is, are stock markets really an efficient mechanism? And here is a very simple table that I would want you to look at. These are five companies, five Indian companies across different sectors. And what is interesting is so there are three columns there. The second column tells us what has happened to the growth in their profit after tax over the last 25 years, the rate at which their profits have grown. And the third column talks about the rate at which the stock price of each of these businesses has grown. And the similarity there is, I would say, is really interesting. So if you look at each of these businesses, it's not like profits have grown at, say, 15%. It's not like their stock prices have grown at even, say, 25%. You would find that in the long run, both these figures sort of, like they say, in the long run, stock markets are slaves to earnings or profits, and which is what is borne out by this chart. So over the last 25 years, we would have had a lot of trading days, a lot of probably each of these stocks would have the volatility in each of these stocks any single year would have been upwards of, say, 30 to 40%. And sometimes even more. But despite all that, in the long run, the truth does prevail. So the bottom line here is stock markets in the long run, because these are auction-driven markets, which are influenced deeply by the human beings who operate participate in these markets. Stock markets act like voting machines in the short run. However, in the long run, they do act like a weighing machine. How much you weigh shows up on the machine. There are no shortcuts to that. Moving on, of course, once you've decided or have thought about giving equity, there are a lot of approaches to bell this cat. And in fact, all those approaches are based on what sort of asset allocation you have. What is your investment horizon? What is your perception about other participants who participate in these markets, and so on and so forth? And having spent a lot of time researching these and having pondered over this over the long run, I think value investing approach is timeless, is scalable. And I'm saying this because I've looked at the best performing fund managers across different investment strategies, different investment philosophies, be it factor-based investing, quantitative investing, technical fundamentals and whatnot. Somehow the value investing approach is very intuitive, is very commonsensical, and is amenable to scale in the long run. One of the problems I have encountered in other investment approaches is as the fund becomes successful, there is a restriction in terms of the capital that they can manage, because beyond a point, those approaches do not work. But on the value investing side, I think sky is indeed the limit. And we'll talk about what value investing is with certain specific examples later during this presentation. Moving on, I think one most important thing that people think about when they hear the word stocks or stock market is risk. Ki stock market bahut risky hai. There's a lot of risk. What if I end up losing my capital, and so on and so forth. So of course, as with any question, a lot of finest human minds have spent a lot of time trying to dissect what is risk. So we will look at the two perspectives there are with regards to risk. The first one is the academic perspective towards risk. And if you've bothered with an advanced degree on the financial services side, be it a CFA or an MBA or any advanced degree that you would have taken, you would have come across the academic treatment of risk. And we will look at the pros and cons of that shortly. But all said and done, I think academia tries to do the unthinkable or the impossible. It says if you have too many Greek variables and try to map all that data that you have, you would be able to reduce risk down to some fancy Greek variables, which is not exactly how it tunes in with reality. For instance, a lot of academic firepower has been spent in assessing if variability or volatility is that equal to risk. And academia believes higher the volatility, higher the risk. And somehow in real world, that is not how things have panned out. The other key approach or basis of academic risk view is there is a direct correlation between risk and return. And this is something very important to associate, because in everyday conversations, we talk about this, that someone took a very high risk and that's why he was compensated. And somehow, so the notion there is that higher the risk, higher the return, lower the risk, lower the return. And if you look at some of the finest businessmen, entrepreneurs, investors on this planet, they have accomplished or they have created a business or have adopted an investment approach which does exactly opposite of this. And we'll look at that shortly. Of course, academia believes markets are perfectly efficient, which is simply not the case. And they also believe all human beings who are participants in these markets are actually rational, which is also far away from the truth. And so to look at how this definition pans out, let's look at how one of the finest practitioners of risk, of investing, thinks about risk. So Buffett, Warren Buffett has a very commonsensical approach towards risk. He does not try to complicate it with any fancy Greek variable. Just because you give him 10,000 data points, he does not come up with some fancy theory. He boils it down to just say, I would say five factors. He says risk depends on what sort of asset you're buying, what is the long-term economic characteristic of that asset, what sort of management are you placing your bet on, how capable are they, how fair can they be expected to treat you in the long run. One of the cornerstone of his investment philosophy is always be conscious of the price that you're paying for an asset, right? Because at some price, every asset is worth investing, and probably at some price, it is not. And of course, finally, you have to factor in the impact of taxation and inflation when you look at it. Now, I think the bottom line here is to think about this. So there have been a lot of academic people who try to become practitioners on the investing side. If someone is interested, I would recommend reading a book called When Genius Failed. It chronicled the rise and fall of one of the most talked about hedge funds called Long Term Capital Management. On its board, it had personal capital of two Nobel laureates, Myron Scholes and Robert Merton, the guys who gave us the option pricing formula. And the irony is as follows. So in 97, they had won the Nobel. And in 1998, long-term capital management went bankrupt. Not just that, it had sort of threatened the stability of global financial system. So what is important when you look at risk is to have a very commonsensical approach towards it. And who better than Buffett? So he said, to finish first, you must first finish. Without that, it does not matter what your fancy model tells you about it. So moving on, I think next we have I would probably consider this the most interesting part of our discussion today, where we look at actual examples. And these are live examples. These are investments that I have made in the partnerships that I run. And we are looking at examples from, say, last year. So the first example that I want to talk about is a company called Matrimony.com. And we would look at how to dissect value from price. So a brief background about the company. So it was founded in 2000. It is a pioneer or market leader when it comes to online matchmaking or matrimonial services. In fact, there are three players in this space. You have Jeevan Sathi, Shaadi, and Matrimony. And what is interesting is of these three players, it's only Matrimony which is profitable and has been generating free cash flow for a while now. So what happened last year? So last year during April, this company was trading at a valuation of 650 crores. And out of that, it had surplus cash of around 250 crores. So which means the core business was available for 400 crores. And looking at their performance, so in FY20, the company had revenues of about 370 crores, and it did, its bottom line was about 30 crores on that. So one of the reasons why markets were so unforgiving in its valuation of Matrimony was low growth. So over the last 4-5 year period, they've had a stagnant top line, roughly in the range of 330-370 crores. And probably that played on how markets valued this company back then. So of course, we felt this is a no-brainer bet at that price, and for the following reasons. So we said, A, it's an online platform business, a digital commerce business, where there are last three players standing. Of those three players, only one player is profitable. And look at the complexity or the difficult nature of the business, that one of the other players, for instance, Jeevan Sathi, right? So Jeevan Sathi is owned by the 800 pound of Indian internet, 800 pound gorilla of the Indian internet space, Info Edge. And look at Jeevan Sathi's performance of FY20. So Jeevan Sathi had revenues of about 85 crores, and it lost 60 crores on that. And what was interesting when you dig a little deeper on Matrimony was its core business, which is the matchmaking business, had superior margins, EBITDA margins upwards of 25% consistently, a pretty able management at the wheel. And what was really interesting is when this company went public in 2017, it raised about 500 crores, of which partly it was offered for sale. The company then was valued at 2,200 crores. So we bought into this company 3 years later at a fraction of that price, one third the price. And if you had to ask any academician, obviously the Matrimony stock had much higher volatility during that 3 year period, but a lower price actually means lower risk as long as you're sure about the business prospects. And another interesting point I want to raise about this business, if you look at the modern digital businesses which are going public, which are raising or becoming unicorns at a frenetic pace every other day, right? They are not profitable, right? In fact, we still live in an era where the Uber of all Ubers is not profitable, right? That is harsh reality. And here was a company which was profitable. In fact, if I take away the losses which they were making on certain ancillary businesses which they were trying to incubate, they were making 60 crores PBT on 300, 350 crore top line. So I said, why not? And of course, the view was in the long run, if this online business platform also evolves like every other, the evolution that we've seen with online platform businesses, where winner takes all, I think that might happen here as well, where there will be above average growth and pricing power. And of course, we were pretty impressed by the superior capital allocation which the company has displayed in recent times. So net-net, we went ahead, placed that bet. And of course, we cannot take too much feedback from the change in price in the short term. But still, the company today is valued almost 4 times of the price at which we bought it last year. And yeah, so I think the bottom line here is always look for mispriced bets. As I think Monish Pabrai said this, he said, heads, I win much, tails, I don't lose much. Look for such kind of bets. Moving on, we will look at another example. This was a very contrarian bet. This is basically from the financial services industry. And let me dwell a bit upon what made this very unique or different. So typically it is said when it comes to financial services, the reputation of the lender or the company is everything. And here I was betting on a company which was on the throes of bankruptcy. Looking at the stats, so it was valued at about 900 crores, and this was as recent as about a year ago. And so Religare Enterprises is actually a core investment company. It owns multiple businesses. Three of them are material for our discussion: the lending business, the equity broking business, and of course the health insurance business here. And what is interesting is the erstwhile promoters and management had sort of drained the company out, and there was a lot of corporate fraud which had happened there, because of which market was betting on the company going bankrupt. And we put on our value investors lens and looked at what was going on under the company. So breaking it down, so looking at each of these three pillars of that business, this is what we found. So on the lending business, so we found that there was a new management at the helm, which had demonstrated huge resolve in overcoming the past misconduct. So they had settled a lot of legacy disputes with various lenders, private equity players. They had wrote off, very interestingly, on a loan book which was less about 7,000 crore. They wrote off their entire corporate loan book of about 2,500 crores. When you do that, that gives some margin of safety for a new investor who's evaluating that business, right? And what was interesting was the company, because of all these things, had sort of convinced the group of lenders to allow it to restart its lending business. I would also touch upon, there was one very specific instance of optionality here. So there was one ongoing litigation, which is still ongoing, between Religa Enterprises and the erstwhile Lakshmi Vilas Bank, which was recently taken over by DBS, and it's called DBS India. So there was a case wherein the FD, which Religare had placed with Lakshmi Vilas Bank, was fraudulently misappropriated towards loan outstanding of some private business of the previous promoters. Now, based on readings of the case, I think there is a greater likelihood that this case would evolve in favor of the company. And just look at the quantum. We bought this company at a 900 crore market cap. And the value, the payoff just from this one litigation for the company would be roughly around 1,000 crore. Of course, it depends on when this finally settles. But yes, that's the quantum that we're looking at. Of course, the second business was broking. And what we liked in broking was it is hard to lose too much capital in there, as long as you don't do a lot of stupid things. And so a low capital intensive business, which was breaking even or turning profitable. So we said, okay, we can't lose money if we buy it. And most importantly, it owns a health insurance business. So it has a subsidiary, which is called Care Health Insurance. It owns 72% stake in that. It's among one of the six standalone health insurers in this country, second largest. And what is interesting is that it has a huge runway. You could literally call it being operational in the sunrise vertical in a huge market like India, where it's growing 30, 40, 50% year on year. And something interesting had happened. So one of the marquee investors, Kidara Capital, which is run by Manish Kejriwal, who was formerly head of Temasek in India, they bought, I think, roughly 17% stake in the health insurance arm, whereby value of the stake which Religare owned in that business turned out to be about 2,200 crores. So this was the value that we were getting against a price of 900 crores in that business. And this was very interesting for us. So we said, this is a bet where there is extremely low risk. Of course, a lot of uncertain outcomes. Would the NBFC be revived or not? Would their stockbroking business come to life, become scalable or meaningful or not? But to ride all of that uncertainty, we had a very strong growing valuable business in its health insurance arm. And I said, this is a great way to own that business. And of course, fast forward it to today. Today, I think the company trades at a valuation close to 5,000 crore as we speak. And recently, it raised funding from marquee investors. I think the Burmans from the Dabur family have also invested. So the company raised about 570 crores at a 4,000 crore valuation. And company is on a timeline to demerge the health insurance business. And when that happens, as share owners of Religa Enterprises, we would be awarded shares in the health insurance business. And just some interesting trivia. So on the unlisted side, the health insurance subsidiary trades at a 10,000 crore market cap based on price at which shares are changing hands in the unlisted space. So this was a very interesting bet, which we went ahead and pulled the trigger on. And so far, so good. Moving on, let's look at another example. This is another, I would say, a very counterintuitive bet in a company called Redington India Limited. Now, a brief background about this company: founded in 93, it started out life as IT hardware seller. So all your laptops, desktops, and so the company used to source these from brands or manufacturers and sell it in the Indian market. Over the last 3 decades, something phenomenal has happened at this company. It went global. So today it's prevalent, or it operates in 37 geographies. And in each of those geographies, including India, it is either number one or number two player. And what is interesting is, and we'll talk about the superior risk management about this company. So let's first look at what was being offered last year. So last year in July 2020, I think this business was trading at a market cap of roughly around 3,300 crores. And look at company's performance in FY20. In FY20, company did a top line of around 51,000 crores. And on that, it had a profit after tax of around 500 crores. Now, I think this is the reason why markets were not really enamored by this business at that point in time, which is that distribution is an extremely brutal, difficult business. And because you work on wafer thin margins, imagine if you are the CEO of Redington and in discussion with, let's say, someone, your counterpart from Apple or some other branded player, what sort of bargaining power do you have in any negotiation, right? So it is a very thankless business, so to say, and which is what has happened. Like I said, so they work on wafer thin margins, gross margins of 5%, operating margins of 2%, and what finally flows down to the bottom line is just 1% of the huge top line that you manage. So there is a lot that could go wrong at their level. And what complicates this further is that they are a reseller in the most fast-paced environment, which is the technology hardware space, right? And let's look at what has happened, or why did we think that Redington was a no-brainer bet at that valuation? And it is for the following reasons. So if you look at tech distribution space, globally, across all markets, it has become a two-player, three-player market. So no longer you have hundreds of players trying their luck, trying to make a dent in that space, so to say. So that this was very clear that no challenges from any new entrant coming in and rocking the boat too much, or any sort of stupidity going on in that space for long. What is interesting about Redington and is that how it has transitioned from being a simple reseller of IT hardware into something being a solution provider, because we are entering a stage where hardware will probably be replaced by a lot of those processes would go to the cloud and so on and so forth, right? And during these 30 years, I think Redington has sort of navigated this fast-paced environment very well. And if you look at the complexity that this company manages, right? So they have about 34,000 channel partners, 4,000 employees, 200 plus warehouses, 250 brands that they cater to. So there is a lot that could go wrong. And if you look at it, right? I think it is very impressive. If you look at the inventory charge and receivables which go bad for them, is really phenomenal. And which is what I think is now reflected in the optimism that markets show in this company. It is now valued at 4 times of the price that it was available roughly a year ago at about 12,000 crore. What is also interesting is there is high growth potential in each of these 30 plus markets that it operates in. And Redington will be, of course, a huge beneficiary of the digitization future that we see it unfolding, more so because of the pandemic. I think the bottom line here is conventionally people have this notion that businesses which have a lot of complexity or difficult businesses are not really great for shareholders. I think Redington is an example where they've embraced complexity to overcome the challenge of lower margins and still crank out respectable return on capital employed over the long run. So this was a very interesting bet that I thought we would all benefit by having looked at it. So moving on, I would also like to just spend a little bit of time on different investment alternatives that you have. So one of the key things to keep in mind while looking at any investment alternative is to look at the following factors. So if you look at it, how is a typical mutual fund structured? So you have a mutual fund where there is no or low skin in the game. So the fund manager whom you entrust your life savings, how much of his net worth is invested in these very stocks that he's going to invest on your behalf? And in fact, recently SEBI had come out with a regulation wherein it said a part of the compensation of the fund manager should be paid out in units of the mutual fund scheme that they manage, and which was, I think euphemistically put, it was not very well received by the mutual fund community. And so the other thing with most investment alternatives is there is a fixed fee. And what is interesting or unique about asset management industry is that despite being a service-oriented industry, this is among the rare industries where it is difficult to know the quality of your service provider in the short run. If you were to go up to a restaurant or any other service provider, right, you know if the service that you're getting is good or not, or what you're paying for it, is it worth it or not, you just know right away. Unfortunately, that is not the case when it comes to the asset management industry. And that's why there is a lot of principal agent conflict that you would see in most structures that are there. Of course, most of these alternatives do not have a specified hurdle rate. I'll probably explain that a bit more. So there is no hurdle rate, there is no high watermark. So the fund manager or the fund manager would get compensated regardless of what outcome he or she generates for the end investor. Now, this classic problem or principal agent conflict was actually very innovatively solved by Warren Buffett. He came up with the interesting set of partnerships. So before he took charge of Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett actually ran a set of partnerships from 1956 to about 1970. And that is where he actually made his money, and which is what helped him to take control of Berkshire Hathaway later on and so on and so forth. But what is really interesting, and the reason why I'm sharing this, is because this can really help us while devising compensation structures across industries. And so Buffett followed this. So he said, A, I would have skin in the game. I would invest or be one of the largest investors in the partnerships that I manage. I would also, so he charged no fixed fee. And he said, I would take a cut only if I perform beyond a hurdle rate. And even that hurdle rate compounded. And not just that, there was also a high watermark that he had to live with. And so this was a very unique construct where, of course, there are millions of asset management firms on this planet. Very rarely do you come across a firm which follows this Buffett partnership's compensation structure. Buffett called it the 0-6-25, where 0 was the fee, 6% was the hurdle, and 25 was the share of profit to the fund manager if he performs beyond the threshold. So here was an interesting product which addresses customers' risks and costs. And so interesting to note, at Kabhi Capital, we also follow the exact same principles that Buffett laid out. Moving on, I think we are fairly close end of the presentation here. I just want to bring all together all that we've discussed. And oftentimes we find a lot of our friends, family members, or ourselves who try to dabble in the marketscape. Why don't I invest a small sum and see what happens out of it? And a lot of us burn our fingers on the stock markets, never to return or to even trust or invest in that asset class through someone. And I actually wanted to bring up an example of one of the finest human minds, which is Sir Isaac Newton. And Sir Isaac Newton was also, despite being the great scientific mind that he had, he was also as human as ours. And he also participated during the roaring bull markets of the 1700s. There was this company called South Sea Company, which had exclusive license, shipping license from the UK crown. And so Isaac Newton had invested in that company, made some money, exited it. And then he saw his friends getting rich every day by having invested in that company. And so he said he invested everything at a higher price. And then eventually he lost all of it. In fact, just to give you a sense, he actually went bankrupt because of this bet. In today's dollar terms, I think he lost roughly around $3 million just on this one bet. So this was Newton's failure. That is something that we should all keep in mind. And to overcome that, I think we should look at the solution which one of the finest practitioners has suggested. So Buffett said the following, which is to trust your capital. If you can't do the work, trust your capital to someone who's doing this and has skin in the game. He always says, look at stock as ownership of a business. That will help you manage times when your stocks are down 40-50%. Because if you're invested for the long run, there will be times when they will be down. But that's the road to riches. And of course, partner with entrepreneurs who are able and trustworthy in the long run. Buy them at reasonable prices. And most importantly, ignore the herd and the headlines. No one got rich by following the herd or getting too worried by the headlines. Yes, just a small snapshot on what we do at Kabhi Capital. Among the very few unique firms which follows Buffett 0625 structure, started very recently. Of course, in the short run, our performance has been better than the indices, far better than the indices. But yeah, it's the long run which will tell us how we do. I would like to actually quote this discussion with a quote. It's actually a poem by a Pakistani poet. It's the title of the poem is Faiz Kehte. And this is very reflective of not just our attitude towards stock markets or investing, but I think this is applicable for a lot of us looking at taking the next risk in life. So Faiz Kehte, so he says, Kuch log tumhe samjhayenge, wo tumko khauf dilayenge. Kuch log tumhe samjhayenge, wo tumko khauf dilayenge. Jo hai wo bhi kho sakta hai. Is raah mein rehzan hai itne, kuch aur yahan ho sakta hai. Rehzan means highway robber. Kuch log tumhe samjhayenge, wo tumko khauf dilayenge. Jo hai wo bhi kho sakta hai. Is raah mein rehzan hai itne, kuch aur yahan ho sakta hai. Are kuch aur to aksar hota hai. Kuch aur to aksar hota hai. Par tum jis lamhe mein zinda ho, ye lamha tumse zinda hai. Ye waqt nahi fir aayega. तुम अपनी करनी कर गुजरो जो होगा देखा जाएगा थैंक यू दैट्स इट फ्रॉम माय साइड आई थिंक वी कुड मूव ऑन टू द क्वेश्चंस
यस थैंक यू पवन एंड नाउ लाइक आई थिंक वी ओपन द फ्लोर फॉर द क्वेश्चंस लाल
Sure. Thank you very much, Pavan. And what a wonderful poem to end the session and your PowerPoint with. I just will take up some questions that we've got from our members on the chat. So let me just go me stop sharing the screen. I'll get to the, just bear with me, guys. So there's a question from our member, Mr. Basant Kumar Dugar from Bangkok chapter. The question is, relying on calculated risk to reward ratio will fetch higher financial gains. Your opinion, please.
Yes, absolutely. The question is, how do you assess risk? If you follow the academic definition of risk, then they have broken it down into pieces which does not make sense, right? So for example, let me give you a very counterintuitive or a very simple example, right? If I had bought Matrimony when it went public 3 years ago at 2,200 crore market cap, when there was hardly any trading history, you could not have known whether it's a high risk, whether it's a high beta stock or a low beta stock, and so on and so forth, right? How many standard deviations is it away from the index, and so on and so forth? You would have actually taken much higher risk. When I bought it at a fraction of that price, actually one third of the price at which it went public, the beta of that stock was much higher. But intuitively, it was much low risk at 600 crore market cap than at 2,200 crore market cap. So have a real interpretation of what is risk. And actually, risk is nothing but losing your capital permanently. So try and avoid that. And that's how compounding works. Compounding does not work by adding more to what you have. Compounding actually works by allowing what you have not to be lost. And that's how you do well over time.
Thank you, Pawan. Just going through other comments, I don't see any other question. I just wanted to open the forum for the members. If they have any question that they want to bring it up.
There is one question. There's one question. During the last year, have you made loss on any stock? If yes, was there any learning from it?
Thanks, Kala.
Sure. I would say most profound and most difficult question. In fact, looking at not just the last year, actually last year would have been very difficult to lose money on a stock because we were offered throwaway valuations. But I think looking at all the mistakes that I have made so far. So of course, the only way one learns is by paying the tuition fee on the markets. And theoretically, you don't get better at this game. So some of the key learnings, I would say, if I were to summarize it, one is always bet on something that you understand, right? Because markets follow this herd mentality. A company which is not doing well, everyone would talk negatively about it. A stock which does well, whether for any rhyme or reason or not, everyone starts painting the narrative about that business and that stock very favorably. So like they said, I think there's a very powerful quote. It says, "Sab bhav ke khiladi hain," and which is what it is. So in the short run, if you were to try to take too much feedback from market prices, then we will end up with the averages. To do better, you have to be disconnected from the averages. That is one learning. The other is never concentrate too much on any stock during at least first few years of your investing journey. I would say the third most important thing would be never borrow money and bet on the markets, because leverage increases or basically it magnifies the outcome, whether on the upside or on the downside. So never take leverage. Do it even if you had to take leverage. Just a small point here. So if you look at Berkshire Hathaway, there was one very interesting study which mapped returns that Berkshire Hathaway has generated over the last 50 years. And so it said the return that Berkshire Hathaway stock has delivered is 20% points higher than the US Treasury bill return during this 50-year time period. And out of this 20% outperformance or alpha, half of that was because of Buffett's stock selection. Half of that was because of leverage. And this is why I say Buffett is probably one of the finest businessmen, where he has constructed leverage, which is very unique. Unlike a lot of hedge funds or investment firms, which take on direct leverage, Berkshire Hathaway has the free float of its insurance operations, right? Now, the benefit of that is that leverage will not be called upon on one fine day by one lender all at once. And that's why Berkshire Hathaway, despite having, I think in during this 50-year period, there have been three or four times when it lost more than 50% of its value, and the firm is still around and will be around probably for centuries ahead.
Okay, the next question is, can you suggest any methods to identify good mutual funds, equity managers?
I mean, the just background for that question, most of us are not full-time equity analyst or the equity researcher. Our profession is something else. And obviously, then we invest through the manager or mutual fund. Do you suggest actually what are the criteria or something like while we choose our investment manager or mutual fund?
Sure. Great question. Yes, I think if we cannot dedicate enough time and effort or even thought process to this, you should have someone else do it. And there are plenty of options. The way I would look at it, of course, given that I'm a practitioner, so most of my net worth is in the firms that I manage. But if I were in your shoes, I would look at a mutual fund where they do not have a lot of schemes, because it's easier to have 100 schemes being launched every single year. So look for mutual funds which do not shutter down schemes, because every scheme which gets shutter down is actually a failure, and they just start afresh with a new scheme. So look for funds which have very limited number of schemes, and look for firms where meaningful part of the net worth of the guys who are going to make those investing decisions, their net worth is invested in the same stocks or in the same schemes where you're putting in your hard-earned money. Do that. And finally, I think stop chasing returns on a lower frequency. I would say equity as an asset class will give you far superior returns, provided you give it a fairly long time period. And that will not happen if you chase returns every quarter. So you see which fund did well last quarter, last month, or last week. That is not the right way to do it. And yeah, probably I would probably look at one of the mutual funds, and this could be very useful for everyone. Parag Parekh manages, I think their long-term equity fund is something that if I were in your shoes, I would probably invest meaningful part of my stock allocation in that scheme. And of course, whenever possible, go direct. That will save you a percent in distribution expenses, but that's okay. That's a smaller part of the worry. By all means, have an exposure towards equity.
Next is Vikas. I'm going to ask you a question. His question is, how should the beginners take a call on a stock which is not giving you profit? If analysis says you should hold it, but your instinct says you should sell, what will be your opinion?
Yeah, hi, this is Vikas. So I'll also try to give the background for the question. So I will not say that I'm a beginner. I was doing it for a while, and then I stopped investments, etc. But then in this pandemic phase, I started again. So sometimes we have a feeling that maybe I'm holding a stock for a very long time, and the analysis says that, yes, you should hold it. But then you also have an instinct that because of your previous experiences, this might go down eventually. And what will be your opinion on these scenarios, Pawan?
Sure. Great question there. I would say the following. So first and foremost, always remember something. Even if you were to make returns on that stock, if you lose your peace of mind because of that, then is that really worth it, right? So if you are not comfortable with it, go ahead and sell. Right, because I'm saying this from personal experience. There have been stocks which did not perform well for 3 years, and then did well. But during that 3-year time frame, right? And this is what I think Albert Einstein said when he talked about theory of relativity. I say, you never know where 30 years of life of your life have gone. But if you own a dud stock, every day counts. Every day when you wait for it to perform or come to life, every day seems like a year probably. And so in such cases, I think you should own whatever you're comfortable with, because it doesn't matter what the analyst is saying, right? Ultimately, it's your temperament, it's your belief, which will help you retain that stock, even if it were to go down 50% from wherever you're thinking or trying to make this decision. So it's a personal choice. If when in doubt, sell. In fact, okay. It's not even a close call, because you're not comfortable with the economic characteristics of the business. Or what it could actually mean is that there are thousands of businesses that are listed on the stock market. In fact, one of the useful constructs which Warren Buffett came up with is it's called the circle of competence, right? So to make a fortune on the stock market, it is not necessary for you to bet on all the 50,000 stocks which are there listed across multiple exchanges. You could do that with just say 20, 30 stocks over a period of time. And those 20, 30 stocks could be from areas or how he defines areas which where you are fairly well versed. So wait for that mispricing in certain area and do it. For example, there is a family, I think a Davis family, who have been passive investors just on the insurance side in the US, very rarely known. There is a book on them called The Davis Dynasty. They are, I think, the third generation now. And all that family does is invest into insurance stocks globally. They've made it to the Forbes list, $1 billion+ in net worth, all by investing just in insurance business. So yes, in fact, if you were to look at the net worth of most of the Forbes billionaires, right? What does it tell us? Most of them are there on that list because of probably ownership of just one business, right? Of course, it's a question of how comfortable are you. So that's why I would urge you to become have a lot more diversification. Own say 10, say anywhere between 15 to 20 stocks. If the mispricing is not huge, wait for it. Okay. There is no necessity to be invested fully always or so on and so forth.
Okay. Thank you.
The next question is Rishabh Gang, you're here. Rishabh?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
Yeah, please ask your question.
So, sir, I was asking about what are your learnings, biggest learnings from your winners as well as mistakes?
Okay, interesting question. I think the biggest learning on both sides, I would say, is humility. And this is something which a lot of us would be able to connect, even in our personal lives, right? More often than not, we think that somehow our worth is not being appreciated, whether in an organization that you work for and so on and so forth, right? And when having spent so much of time and effort in this space, what I found was, and this was very soothing at some level, is that there are businesses which solve real world problems, employing thousands of people, having been around for decades altogether with millions or billions in net worth. And even they are, I would say, markets value them very harshly, right? When that can happen to the fortunes of thousands of individuals, some of the finest minds working for these companies. And there are times when the worth of a company does not get recognized for a 5-year period, 10-year period, right? So what does it tell us? I think it tells us that humility is a very serious lesson for all of us. Never to be swayed too much by it in either direction. And I think real money is always made when you go contrarian. By going contrarian, I don't mean to say take excessive risks, In fact, based on the examples that we discussed, look for opportunities where markets are mispricing risk, where if the worst case scenario is not that bad, where you won't lose anything at all. And if you're right, you would make a huge return on that. And I think this is what Jeff Bezos said. He said, for you to have, for you to accomplish something worthwhile, you must be willing to be misunderstood by a lot of people for a long period of time. And that is only possible if you stop taking feedback from everyone at a very short-term frequency, right? Otherwise, you'd be like a boat without without an anchor. You'd be swaying in every possible direction. And that's a recipe for mediocrity, for a business, for an individual, for all of us.
Okay, thank you. Next is Jyoti. Are you there? Jyoti?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah. Please ask your question, Jyoti.
Yeah. Hi, Pawan. I wanted to know about how does value investing framework evaluate the platform businesses like IEX? Because there are no entry barriers in this and they don't have much assets. And so how do we go about valuing it?
Okay. Good question. In fact, I would probably go a step further and look at platforms like, say, Matrimony. The reason why I chose Matrimony is because it is a platform, or the area in which they operate is not regulated, right? For instance, for you to open an energy exchange, you still have to be registered. So there are, so to say, an entry barrier. But you and I could come up with a matrimonial site today over the weekend, crank up something and go live. So that's a far more unregulated structure, I would say. And this is a very timely question, because people typically believe that value investing is all about looking at what is cheap statistically. There was a point in time when during the Industrial Revolution or say 50 years ago, when real value of a business used to reside in hard assets, which is no longer the case. And as a value investor in the 21st century, we will have to know the real worth of intangible assets. So while looking at, say, a platform like that, right? So if I'm looking at, say, IEX as a platform, how do I ensure that there won't be any other new entrant or even an incumbent who would not take away much of their advantage? Now, the beauty about whether a platform business is working or not is when you start seeing the winner is beginning to take all of the economic benefits of that segment. Now, till the time it does not happen, evaluating a business is very difficult during that phase, and which is what I think Matrimony falls in that segment very neatly. So while evaluating Matrimony or IEX, I would look at what sort of growth you would see in that space in times to come, and how much of that value could IEX capture? Because let's say the platform which IEX has is very different, given that it's regulated. There are, let's say, restriction in terms of what it can charge and so on and so forth, right? Versus a platform like, say, Matrimony. So Matrimony, over the last 5 years, I think they've increased their average ticket size or what they charge their paying customers by about 20-25%, which is much higher than, let's say, the inflation rates that we might have experienced. So is that so that way I look for, A, can there be a pricing power? Because only when there is pricing power and the winner is taking all economic benefits or most of the economic benefits of that platform play, can you really call it a platform play? And honestly, when it comes to such industries where the future is actually still very uncertain, I would say you would have to constantly keep reevaluating your intrinsic value of that business at some regular frequency. It's not a very stable business like a toll road where you could just do some projection and say this is how much the company is bound to make within certain ranges. There is a possibility of a huge surprise on the upside when it comes to such businesses.
Okay, thank you. We can take two last questions, Pawan. Two last questions, please, participants. we'll be winding up the session with the last two questions. Any questions?
Yeah, this is Lakshman here.
Yes.
Would like to know, if we look at the portfolio of most of the equity funds, most of them are investing in almost the similar type of businesses. Like if you look at Aditya Birla or any of the big funds, equity funds, they would be having similar type of portfolios. Whether it is good to invest in, how do you choose between these mutual funds, which one to look for, or is it better to go in for index-based funds for your investments?
Okay, so I would recommend, I think index funds would beat most of active fund managers hands down in over the next, say, two decades or so. The experience when it comes to Indian stock markets over the last two decades was very different, when a lot of active managers could beat the index. But I think as markets mature, index funds are far more compelling. So always have, let's say, out of your equity basket, have some exposure or allocation to index funds, and then look at mutual funds or fund managers who are doing it very differently.
Okay, thank you. The last question, please.
Hello, this is Prashant here.
Yes.
Obviously, all of us are here in Singapore, and the world is open for us to invest, and we can invest globally anywhere in any equities. How do you benchmark the global equity versus Indian equity? And do you suggest any particular ratio, how much we invest in India vis-a-vis how much we invest in outside global equities?
Great
overall, what is your view of the relative growth in India in the next 20 years in equity versus the rest of the world?
Okay. So I will be taking a bit of medicine myself that I so professed at the start, which is not to make any fancy projections about the unknown future. So with that in place, I would actually spend 2 minutes talking about the prospects of India. And this is, so I believe India is, if you look at in the context of business and stock returns, last decade was not so great from the Indian context, and which leads me to believe that the next decade or so should be much better for the following reasons. If you look at it, the corporate balance sheet in India is the least stressed today over the last two decades. Debt as a percentage of, say, total assets of the India Inc.'s balance sheet is among the lowest. Interest cost as a percentage of total expense is among the lowest. And there are a lot of regulatory, I would say, headwinds or a lot of, I would say, structural changes which the government here has implemented in recent times, which will start paying off in the long run. One example which I give to a lot of people, right? So for example, during the COVID pandemic, the stimulus, for example, take the most capitalized country, US, right? So if you are eligible for a stimulus check for the government stimulus in the US, you had the option of taking that either as a check or by having it credited to your bank account, right? Compare that with a country like India, where if you're getting, say, 400 rupees on your LPG cylinder as a subsidy, you have no option, but it gets credited directly to your bank account. And I would say that is something to be really happy or optimistic about. So a lot of changes on the ground have happened, which would start paying off huge benefits over the next decade. So I'm very optimistic about Indian businesses or prospects of Indian businesses over the next decade or so. And so have an exposure towards India for sure. And maybe I might be biased, but allocation to global equities versus Indian equities is a function. It's a very personal thing. So for example, someone who's drawing salary in, say, Singapore dollars, versus some part of their net worth residing in Indian rupee versus, so there is all of that thing that you will have to envisage or think about. But I would say, depending on where you wish to settle down finally in life, how you define, or where you think you would want to consume a lot of sometime down the line, or have a purchasing power in that economy, position your assets or position assets and currencies accordingly based on that. And which is where I think the first level definition of investing was very useful. Are you buying an asset which is improving its productivity? Because if that happens, it doesn't matter what happens to currency exchange rates and all of that. In the long term, you'll be a net beneficiary of that. So bottom line, I would urge say a 60-40 allocation, where 60% could be Indian equities and 40 could be global. But yeah, that's a very personal judgment to make.
Thanks, Pavan. Thank you very much. And I now invite our member, CA Shanti Lal, to conclude the session. Lal?
Sure, Kala. Thank you very much. Wow, what a jam power pack session that we had for last 90 minutes. A lot of interactive questions, a lot of wisdom and knowledge. But first, I'll start with thank you so much, Pavan, for your generosity in sharing your time and expertise with our ICI Singapore chapter. I also would like to thank our chapter members for actively participating in this session and making this session a very successful and interactive. I hope we all got to learn a cent or two from last 90 minutes and expect that we implement that in our day-to-day life. Thank you, everyone, once again. And just a quick note on the poll. So we had created a poll in terms of the question that we asked. The question was, what will you choose? Option one, taking a 5 crore now on a winning lottery, or option two, take a rupee now, which will get doubled each day for the next 30 days. We've got the results. Around 80% have replied back saying they'll take a rupee now, which will double for the next 30 days. And 20% opted to take basically 5 crore now. I just wanted to share this, the answer which takes away the maximum prize is having a 1 rupee now, which doubles every day. And that shows the power of compounding. At the end of 30 days, that 1 rupee becomes 53 crores.
Thank you.
With that note, I would like to thanks once again, Kala, Pavan, Preetji, for allowing the session on the chapter. And thank you, Mr. Pavan Kumar, for spending the last 90 minutes with us.
Thank you. Thank you, Lal. Thanks. And also thanks for the poll results, which you have seen, which is like wise to choose the 1 rupee or the 5 crores. Thanks once again to all of you. Our next formal session is on September 16th. More details will be shared in our group. Stay tuned. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.